Hello everyone at Silver, this is Dimensionals. This is a deck builder, kind of, but not in the traditional way. Honestly, this game feels more like a real-life tabletop deck building game, something like Sentinels of the Multiverse or something like that. It kind of has that sort of feel to it, as opposed to like a Slay the Spire style of things. The idea here is you are a group of basically superheroes called the Dimensionals that go across the various dimensions and try to save them from this evil corrupting force. You've got a party of three that you can choose from, and each person can have up to four skills attached to them. This is the deck building part. You don't have cards. Instead, everyone has skills, and all of their skills are available at the same time. You don't draw a hand. But of course, every skill has a mana cost, and you will start with just a small amount, and every turn you'll get more and more, and then you'll just sort of cast each character's skills in a way that you survive the fight and move on. And there are a couple of different gameplay modes currently in the game. There's a campaign mode that is going to have all of the various dimensions that you can go through. In the current state of the early access, it has the water dimension, which consists of 8 pretty long levels that took me about 5 hours to go through. And then you also have the roguelite mode, which is your randomized adventure where you can select your whole team from all the different characters that are currently in the game, which is quite a few, and go on an increasingly difficult roguelite adventure with that, which is definitely going to give you more than the 5 hours of the campaign. There's a lot more gameplay there, but I really like that they include the campaign because, for one, it just helps with the presentation of the game being this, like, Saturday morning cartoon superhero show kind of concept, but also it introduces you to a lot of the mechanics and stuff really well in a way that doesn't feel like an overbearing tutorial. The campaign often gives you a specific list of things that each character starts with that helps each campaign mission kind of have its own build, and it helps you understand how to build these characters and what sorts of builds that are possible to make in the game. So it's kind of like a catalyst for your own creativity. You just sort of do the campaign missions and it shows you the various ways that these characters can be used. There is a lot of build variety in this game, especially in the roguelite mode, because you've got 3 characters, and each character, although they only have 4 slots, they do have about 20 skills associated with each of them, so that's a lot of different possibilities that you could go to. And then you'll go screen by screen, battle by battle, just smacking enemies down and earning new attacks and abilities and things that you can. You have sort of a big inventory of skills. You don't have to automatically equip them. You'll notice that you can't skip a reward, which is common in roguelites, deck builders especially. The ability to skip a reward if you don't want to add anything to your deck is a smart thing to do. But in this case, it gets added to an inventory. You don't have to use it. So there's no point in skipping. It's always nice to have something because at the very least, you can just sell it if you want to. You have very fine control of what each character can do. You don't add things to a deck, you add things to an inventory and then drag and drop stuff from that inventory to each of your characters. So you have 100% fine control over what all of your characters can do at any given time. Speaking of the way the game is presented, by the way, it's really cool. The presentation here is super polished, despite the fact that it is an early access game, and, you know, obviously there's a lot of assets that aren't done and stuff. What is currently in the game is hyper-polished feeling, and the way that the game is presented, like I said, is kind of like a Saturday morning cartoon or like a sort of graphic novel, like a superhero graphic novel sort of concept. It's a really cool presentation. You'll see things like those little ink dots at the bottom of the screen, like a graphic novel, and when you move your mouse, they sort of warp around your mouse cursor, which is a cool touch, all the way down to things like the teleport effect, which is really pretty and looks super cool and is very colorful, and like I said, it's got that sort of cartoon aesthetic to it that looks really nice. And the game also has some cartoon cutscenes that are all like hand-drawn in the style and look really, really good. And there's quite a lot of voice acting here as well, and the voice acting is equally bright and sunny and cheerful and just fun, like a cartoon. The music also follows suit as another important part of the presentation. The music is great and is the kind of thing that you could imagine there being, like, you know, an early morning show before you go to school of something called the Dimensionals, and this would be the theme song. You can feel it, you can see it, and it's really cool that they've managed to create this sort of cohesive presentation for the game, even in its early state, that's so well done. The way the campaign works is you're going to go between each dimension in a story sort of setting, and you're going to unlock new heroes from that specific dimension as you go. So it's going to slowly introduce you to all the characters of that element as you go through each one. And each mission will have a pre-selected set of 3 characters that you use, each with a set of items and stuff that they start with, to give you a sort of head start on a specific type of build that mission wants you to know exists and wants you to sort of expand on as you go through it. And most of them are six battles, each increasingly difficult, although there is one that's seven. So I think that sometimes when it comes to the important story boss battles, there may be some extra stuff added onto those to give them some extra difficulty. But also the eighth, the final mission, is just one big boss battle that's really big and multi-phase and quite difficult, but really fun to conquer. And then by that point, you will have unlocked all of the heroes of that element, as well as experienced several different kinds of builds that that element has to offer. And then you'll move on to the next world, which will be its own new element and with its own new characters and builds and all that, and you'll start over. And in this case, book two, the second sort of season of the campaign, is going to be the Fire World. So that's not currently in the game yet, but I suspect it probably will be soon, because I'm guessing they're going for a we don't want to put anything in the game partially kind of setup, where everything that's currently available feels quite finished. They're going for that type of early access where instead of putting a whole bunch of stuff in, but like 50% of it is done and 50% of it is still like placeholder, instead they're putting something in that's like 90% done, which means there's less content overall, but all the content that's there is way more polished. However, the roguelite mode does have more content. You will find some new bosses and new enemies and other types of things in there that you didn't see before, and there are also a lot more heroes to choose from. You've got all the ones that you could use in the campaign, but you've also got several fire world heroes and some nature or earth world heroes, some sort of green, verdant characters with some really neat capabilities and lots of poison and stuff like that. And eventually there's going to be even more than that as the early access continues. So you can create a custom team of three of whoever you want. In between fights, you can do things like go to a shop. You don't have to get to a shop node. Instead, you can just choose to go to the shop whenever you want before a fight. And the shop does not refresh on its own. You have to pay to refresh it, but the cost to refresh it resets back down to only 10 gold after every battle. So, you know, after you refresh it a couple of times, it starts getting a little bit expensive. You can just wait, do a battle, and come back and refresh it again for less. And this keeps you having a lot of new stuff available to you at any given time, because the shop will always have a choice between three different items that you can buy, usually at really fair prices, honestly. This is one of the only roguelites I've played where almost every time I go to the shop, I can buy something. You know, most stuff in the shop costs around like 70 coins or so, and you often get around 80 minimum from a fight, so you usually have a good supply of new stuff coming in. Although, of course, if the shop happens to randomly roll a super high rarity skill or something, like an epic or a legendary, those cost a lot more. I think epics cost like 300, but that very rarely happens, so you're going to want to save up for those if you can. But if you're not seeing those, there's still plenty of new stuff for you to buy, which is cool, and it means that the overall build variety has a lot of moving parts, a lot of stuff that you can swap in and out. Also, you can upgrade things. If you have a duplicate of a skill, you can drag them together and pay 100 gold to upgrade them to a tier 2 version of that skill, which is usually much better than the tier 1 version. And if you have two tier 2 versions, you can drag them together and pay a lot more to upgrade it to a tier 3. This is as high as skills can go, but they are very, very strong at this stage. But all of the skills you can find are not just active skills that you can cast during combat. There are also lots of passive ones. There are common passives that affect everyone and can be equipped to anyone. And there are also more character-specific passives that you gotta make room for, because these do take up the same slots as your active skills. So just because you have four slots doesn't necessarily mean you're gonna have four attacks available to you. You may want to fill one or two of them with passives instead to accentuate the build you're going for, because the passives in this game tend to be really powerful, so they're a smart thing to have several of on hand, and they can also be upgraded just like the active skills can. Also, I should probably have mentioned before that every character has a passive that is not in these slots. They have a character-specific passive that's unique to them that they just always have no matter what. This helps to it helps you understand how to build that character. It's not like incredibly narrow. You know, the passive doesn't require you to build in one hyper-specific way, but it does give you an idea of what they're good at. Like, for instance, the main character of the story, Koa, he gets a passive that gives him extra crit chance. So there's a lot of different ways to take advantage of that, a lot of builds that will work well with extra crit chance, but stuff that hits multiple times and refreshes a bunch of times so you can use it repeatedly, that kind of thing, tends to benefit a lot from that. So it gives you a basic kind of guideline for how you might want to build him. I really like the fact that there are so many active and passive skills of various rarities associated with each hero, like 20, like I said. So this means that there's just so much that you can come across when you're in the middle of a run. You know, that's like a pool of 60 different skills that you're pulling from because of the three characters each time. So that's really cool. That gives you a lot of different things to experiment with, which is where a game like this tends to shine. So not only is this game very colorful visually, but it's also really colorful in its build variety and stuff, because there's so many different strategies for you to adapt and so many different kinds of skills for you to find and see if you can make them work and upgrade them and stuff. This means that this game's finest point is its character and build variety. That's the main thing that really carries it, that helps it stand out, is just how much stuff there is for you to do with your party. And of course, a lot of this, a lot of the characters are not unlocked at first. You will start with about 6 characters in the roguelite mode, but there are an additional 6 that you can unlock through doing various challenges, like beating certain bosses in specific ways or getting to certain thresholds without using consumables and things like that. You do, of course, have a backpack that has consumables in it, by the way. It's got 3 slots, and you can hold various potions and things in it to use during battle. These don't take mana, and they don't take a turn to use. They're free to use. But of course, they also have a small number of total charges, so you will run out of them quickly. You got to use them at just the right time. One thing I forgot to mention earlier, by the way, is that the composer of this game's music is actually the same composer for Gravity Falls, so that's probably why it's so good. Also, in the roguelite mode, you will find that some of the skills, of those 20 skills for each hero, are actually locked, and you can, whenever you take a hero into a run, you'll level them up, and as you level them up, they'll unlock more of their repertoire of skills, all the way up until you get to their legendary stuff late in the unlocks. And you can also choose to get some skill points and assign those skill points to enhance their capabilities and make them stronger. So this means that the heroes don't always start exactly the same, and instead you can choose to enhance various aspects of them with these skill points and make them more powerful. So the more that you bring your favorite heroes, the stronger they'll get and the more options they'll get. Overall, I think Dimensionals is a really solid roguelite deck builder that's doing things a bit differently, and its aesthetic and its overall presentation is super well realized, and also its build variety and its hero variety and stuff is a really high point that makes it just really fun to play another run. That's kind of the thing that a lot of people are looking for when it comes to this genre, is that just one more run feeling, and this game does it very well because of its huge amounts of variety. Seeing how polished and nice everything that's currently in the game is, it makes me really excited to see what they add next. And this is the kind of game that is starting out really, really solid, but is only going to get better as updates flow in because of how polished they're making the content before they implement it and how much there is. I have a feeling that every time they do a new major update, they're going to add so much great new stuff that everyone is going to want to come back and try it all out immediately. This is just one of those games. And I hope that it sees a good amount of success, because there's a lot of love and passion that's obviously being poured into this for it to be this good already. And I'm definitely excited to see where it goes from here. And I'll probably be updating you in the future when it comes to the new campaign levels and the new heroes and stuff, once some more of that stuff gets added later on down the line. So I'll put the link in the description below this video to the Steam Store page for Dimensionals if you guys wish to check it out yourselves. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.